Hachette Audio presents Hollywood Black, written and read by Donald Bogle, foreword written by John Singleton. For my parents, Roslyn and John, and for three terrific Bogles, Roger, Jerry, and Jay. Foreword by John Singleton. I grew up living behind a Los Angeles landmark, the Century Drive-In Theater. At night, I'd watch the images on two giant screens. Without hearing any sound, I could see horror movies, action films, and my favorites, blaxploitation movies, right outside my bedroom window. Images of Ron O'Neill running in platform shoes and Pam Grier kicking ass and looking sexy occupied my young mind. I think that marked the beginning of my lifelong movie odyssey, to see as many films as I could and to figure out the way the directors, writers, and actors told stories on screen. Because I was most affected by the black movies, I asked myself how those black people got on screen. Who put them there? Even then, my struggle was to make the fantasy of filmmaking become my reality. Later, when I was a film student at the University of Southern California, I would glean everything I could about the history of blacks in cinema. As I began to watch the older pre-World War II movies, and then the post-war black films that ran into the 60s and 70s, I noticed a significant change in the way African Americans were depicted. I could sense that in the early films, black actors were told by white filmmakers to smile broadly or to pop their eyes wider in this shot or that one. Those films were created for mainstream audiences, hence the various stereotyped racial tropes. The grinning, bug-eyed, cartoonish images were there to make white folks feel comfortable. A lot of pure talent was twisted and distorted. But I also noticed other films in which black performers gave more nuanced, often moving performances, such as Louise Beavers and Freddie Washington, as the black mother and her light-skinned daughter, who are torn apart because of race in the original version of Imitation of Life. I also was impressed by the great Paul Robeson in the 1933 Emperor Jones. Here was a proud, defiant, strong, even arrogant black man, determined to call the shots in his life, to be a master of his own destiny. Later, with the dramatic ascent of Sidney Poitier as a powerful actor in 1950s films like No Way Out and Blackboard Jungle, black Hollywood began to evolve. Watching the smoldering and sexually charged heat and passion of Dorothy Dandridge and Harry Belafonte and Carmen Jones, I know now that Dandridge's strong screen presence was a revolutionary precursor to Halle Berry's Oscar-winning performance in Monsters Ball. At USC, my knowledge of movies that had come before, good and bad, was something that fortified me for my future as a filmmaker. I also had the benefit of entering college after having just seen She's Gotta Have It. I was knocked out by it, and when I met its director, Spike Lee, I had the feeling I could be a part of a revolution, a new wave of African-American filmmaking. Reading Hollywood Black, I'm carried back to my sense of discovery of black movie history. And looking through the pictures in this book, I am reminded of my emotions as I watch the films for the first time. Those emotions and images are indelible. Richard Roundtree in Shaft, walking through Harlem head high, owning the street with his stroll. Cicely Tyson and Paul Winfield running to each other in Sounder. Richard Pryor in all his comic genius in Which Way Is Up. Or Eddie Murphy with his cool swagger in Beverly Hills Cop. I recall the emotional surge I felt when seeing Do the Right Thing, a seminal film that pushed me as a film student to write the screenplay for Boys in the Hood. I also remember the well in my heart at seeing the movie version of my childhood comic book hero, Black Panther. This book brings all that back to me, and I've been all the more enlightened by the great historical links between Black filmmakers like Oscar Micheaux, sometimes pronounced Michaud, and Noble Johnson in the silent era, to those bold dudes of the late 1960s and 1970s, such as Gordon Park Sr. and Melvin Van Peebles, right up to filmmakers like myself and into the new millennium. It also shows the links between actors as diverse as Paul Robeson, Sidney Poitier, Denzel Washington, Will Smith, Viola Davis, Angela Bassett, and so many others. I found this book to be an enjoyable, insightful reflection of how, despite tremendous obstacles, Black film artists triumphed in showing their humanity and their brilliance to the world. Donald Bogle's Hollywood Black, The Stars, the Films, the Filmmakers, encapsulates the historical essence of the Black movie-going experience in this country. And I'm proud to be a part of it. This is an invaluable book that moviegoers have been waiting for and will treasure. Introduction. For Blacks in American movies, it's been a long, sometimes turbulent, and often rocky journey through the 20th century into the 21st. Foremost, it is a journey that, surprisingly, is often unknown and rarely explored. Some moviegoers mistakenly assume that African Americans first worked in film sometime in the 1950s, with the emergence of such Eisenhower-age stars as Sidney Poitier and the often neglected Dorothy Dandridge. Others also mistakenly believe that Black filmmakers did not arrive on the scene until Spike Lee in the mid-1980s, or, for those with deeper knowledge, in the 1970s, with such bold and daring directors as Melvin Van Peebles and Gordon Park Sr., and such well-known movies as Shaft or Superfly. But, of course, these stars and filmmakers are only part of the story. The history of Blacks in American films is long, rich, and extraordinarily extensive, with remarkable achievements stretching back to the era of silent films, before Hollywood was even Hollywood as we now think of it, and progressing with the advent of sound into the late 1920s, through the Depression and the World War II years, right up to the present. There is a whole body of work that has been ignored or glossed over. Hollywood Black seeks to set the historical record straight. It charts that long journey, examining cinema that is often disturbing, but also compelling and engrossing. This book spotlights the way that films and film stars reflect the social and political attitudes and perspectives of the eras in which they first appeared, and the way those films and film stars looked both in the past and to later generations. Often we may find it hard to fathom how past moviegoers could have accepted Hollywood's stereotyped view of Black America. But while some films and personalities are stuck in the past, others gloriously transcended it. Hollywood Black presents a gallery of important talents both in front of the camera and behind it. Actors, actresses, writers, directors, producers, who struggled against the odds to make unique statements on screen. More than we might imagine, some fought to overturn stereotypes and to speak to audiences, especially African-American moviegoers, in personal and often striking terms. Such disparate figures as Paul Robeson, Eddie Rochester Anderson, Hattie McDaniel, Ethel Waters, Puerto Rico-born Juana Hernandez, Ruby Dee, Rex Ingram, Cicely Tyson, Louis Gossett Jr., Denzel Washington, Angela Bassett, Harry Belafonte, Viola Davis, Spike Lee, John Singleton, Julie Dash, Jordan Peele, and Ryan Coogler. Having written previously about African-American movie history in a series of books, notably Toms, Coons, Mulattoes, Mammies, and Bucks, an interpretive history of blacks in American films, as well as in Dorothy Dandridge, a biography, and Bright Boulevard's Bold Dreams, the story of Black Hollywood, I found that writing Hollywood Black has been a unique adventure. The history, while still comprehensive, is told more concisely here. In a manner different from my previous books, I also let an array of photographs included in the PDFs illustrate the tale. Some of the photographs here have rarely been published. These seldom seen photographs serve to bring a movie and an era to startling life. For those who've seen the films, the photographs no doubt will summon up long forgotten movie going experiences. In other cases, the photographs may introduce the listener to films or performers they haven't seen and will very much want to. Seeing such photographs of Nina Mae McKinney, Rex Ingram, Daniel Haynes, Stepin Fetchit, Freddie Washington, Teresa Harris, Eartha Kitt, Cicely Tyson, Lena Horne, Lupita Nyong'o, Will Smith, Whoopi Goldberg, or Eddie Murphy can be an involving and sometimes enlightening experience. The photographs speak in a voice of their own. Hollywood Black presents an up-close view of some of the most important cinematic works of the past 100-plus years, as well as some of the more neglected. Sometimes popular, though not critically acclaimed, movies comment on issues, concepts, and dilemmas in an immediate way, minus fanfare or pretensions. Popular films can strike a nerve that jolts us. A drama like the original 1934 version of Imitation of Life, with its tear-jerker subplot about a submissive black mother rejected by her assertive light-skinned daughter who sets out to fulfill herself by passing for white, took America by surprise and suggested, without fully examining, a long-festering race problem that most Depression-era movies chose to ignore. In the end, Imitation of Life affected the African-American community in a gut-wrenching manner, unlike most other Hollywood film fare of the day. A movie like the 1943 Stormy Weather, with its array of major black performers, such as Lena Horne, Bill Bojangles Robinson, Fats Waller, Catherine Dunham, Cab Calloway, and the astounding Nicholas Brothers, appeared to be rewriting American entertainment history, revealing dazzling talents whose sheer brilliance often went unacknowledged. The same is true of the other black film released in 1943, Cabin in the Sky, with its all-star cast of Ethel Waters, Eddie Rochester Anderson, Duke Ellington, Lena Horne, Louis Armstrong, Rex Ingram, Mantan Moreland, Butterfly McQueen, that smooth gliding dancer John Bubbles Sublette, and the stride piano player Ford.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.